So, my name is Yves, I'm from Titansoft. So today, I'm going to share about our journey in Agile in the past 10 years, the problem we face, and what countermeasure we have implemented along the way, and our learnings. So a bit introduction about our company. We have 82 people in Singapore from 12 different countries. So we are a very typical small and medium enterprise here in Singapore. In Singapore, the definition of small and medium enterprise is any company less than 200 people. So I guess there are two reasons why I'm here today. First reason, because we are a very typical small company. So we're facing the other issues or the other benefits the other small company do in Singapore. So we also enjoy the effective governance system, and also facing a challenge like always increasing operational expense, also the lacking of IT pool. Especially, I heard Mr. Chen's speech yesterday that government is going to hire programmers, which also made me very worried. Yeah, because we are competing on the IT talent as well. The second reason why we are here, why I'm here today, is because probably because we made enough mistakes, so we learned something along the way, and probably that's why I'm today here. So when we look back for the past 10 years, we can divide into four different ages or different age of time, and we have different behaviors or different ways of working in each different ages. So I will go through the age one by one. I'll start with the first age, with the story of movie theater. So normally, when you go to a movie, where would you sit? In the center, right? You'll sit in the center. However, when I go to a movie, this will be the seat I pick. Yeah. So because I was taking up as a pro at customer service, and I also as a project manager. So because I was the only one, so I need to answer the phone call anytime. And as if you are taking up, how many people here actually taking up support role or you do standby and you work from time to time? No? Oh, lucky you. Okay. So if you are doing the support or you are standing by all the time, you will know that wherever you stay at home or you've got nothing to do, the phone will keep silence. However, whenever you go out for party or you go out for movies, the phone will ring, right? That's what happened to me. So I always pick the seat which I can get to the exit fast this way. And the reason I'm doing that because I think I was quite good at knowing our system, because I always start to work with our system from day one. And for 3 years, I've been standby 24/7, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 3 years. It sounds very miserable, however, I did not feel so. I feel that I'm like a Superman. Because I know how to deal with all the tasks, and I'm very good at it. I know how to communicate with our customers. And not only me, I believe all our team members, they feel the same way. They feel like they are good superheroes. So I call this age of heroes at this point in time. However, it's not so easy to be heroes, because if there are people from China, you will know that currently in China, the working hour in most of software companies, they have a working scheme called 996. 996 means 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., 6 days a week. That's how they work in China now. And our working hour was much longer than that. So it's not really easy to be heroes, as you can tell from this statistic. The red line is our headcount. So we increased from 5 people to 25 people in 4 years. And the yellow line is actually the turnover rate. It's how many people left in our company. So as you can see on the 206, there are 70% turnover rate. When we only have 7 people, so left. So we really had a hard time how to keep people because our working hour is very intensive and very long. However, by 2007, the turnover rate dropped. But we didn't change our way of working, actually. I guess just people get used to it. They get used to these intensive working hours. This is our organization chart by that time. Because actually, I didn't know what's organization chart. And I was an engineer. How many managers are here? Or taking out like project managers, department managers, okay. About 20%, 30%. I'm going to tell you a little secret, that engineers don't like managers. Okay. Like engineers, what we think is we do all the hard work, and the managers take all the credit, right? Yeah, then that's what, yeah, okay. That was what I thought back then. Then, so we are proud that we are all our engineers. We don't need a manager in our team. And we don't need a management system. And we are happy the way we work. Until something happened in my life, and someone, or rather someone came into my life and changed my life forever. This is my daughter. She was born in 2009. So by 2009, and after she was born, then I realized I cannot be the only one who's doing a support. Right? Can we imagine that for the customer call me and say, hey, we got an issue. Wait for 5 minutes, I'm going to change my diapers. Change the diaper for my daughter. It's not possible. So I got to somehow outsource or let other people do the work I do. And also at that point of time, I like to be a hero, so it's very sad. But who is going to do our work? Because at that point of time, we are so familiar with our system. And we spend so much time to see the user growing. We like what we are doing. So we really don't like to let the new guys do our work. Because you know the new guys, they are very stupid, right? They make all the mistakes. But because all of us, we start to get to an age of married, we start to have kids, we cannot spend that long hours working anymore. So those are the things we try to do to make other people, all the normal people, know how to do the hero's task. And some of them works quite well, some of them took us some time to learn. I will not go into the detail because we don't have enough time, but I'm happy to discuss afterwards. By lessons learned during that period of time, it's always rely on the team, not individual. If the sustainable is the key. Sometimes sustainable is not very important. Like in a startup, you don't know whether you will survive next year or next month or next week. So it's kind of luxury to talk about sustainable. However, if the business is there, you need to rely on a team to make things work. Because individual, they are very weak, right? They are very vulnerable. They can get sick. They can get, they will be leaving the organization. So it is from the risk management perspective to rely on team, not individuals. Then we enter into a different age, which is like we cut the big system into smaller modules. So we enter the age of my curves, which means each of us will have different area to protect, to work on. And I will take care of my area and you will take care of yours. So we go into the specializations. In this age, we spend a lot of time on the organization structures. So we have different, now we know how to draw the organization chart. So we have a different functional departments, and we even have different functional teams. We focus on different like front-end and back-end teams. We even go further. We go further into one department handle the development, the other department handles the operations. So guess what happened? No programmer want to work in the operation team, right? Nobody wants to fix other people's bug. And everyone wants to be in the development team because in the development team, you get to play with all the cool stuff, all the new stuff. And nobody wants to go to the maintenance team. So we can't change that just like after a couple months. Different responsibility actually resolve some issues. This is our incident rate. As you can see, we have no data before 2007. Because we are so chaotic, we don't keep any data, we don't need managers, right? So after 2007, we start to report some data. And actually, by specialization, the incident reduced by 50%. And HR turnover rate maintains quite high. At that time, it was 30%. And we have about 40 people by then, so every year, about 10 people were left. The number seems high, but it did not matter to me at that point in time because I know in average, maybe in IT, turnover rate of 20 to 30 is quite normal. That is what I thought. So I didn't pay attention to that. Rather, I was paying attention to how do we deliver the software faster because users are increasing and we cannot keep up with the speed, how to deliver functions. So we try various ways how to make the delivery faster. And personally, I think most effective one is to change the scope. So we can push a small scope to the market to test out if the market really wants it before we invest more time into it. And I think the most, what the customer want the most, or the, what they like the most is the, this one. It's a secret developer toolbox, which means it's to copy and paste, skip the test, skip the unit test, and hard coding. Because the customer was hit very, very fast, right? I guess there are many programmers here, you all know this is really the quickest way to show the outcome. And it has some consequences though, we will face in a later age. So what I learned in this age is that software delivery is easy, however maintenance is the hard part. Because especially if your business is growing, if your business is not growing, you don't have the requirement to change, you don't need to change, then everyone will be happy. However, if you got to keep up with the business, you need to make some change to the requirements, then it's become very hard. By 2012, I have a gap year. I have a gap year, 1 year off from my work. And this year, I was calling to do the national service. Because I am from Taiwan, and every mayor in Taiwan, we got to serve for 1 year. I've been delayed for quite some time, so I need to go back. And I am really grateful for this experience because I got to experience something different from my work. And in knowing this big system, in a big system, what you have been told to do is often different from what you are actually doing, right? So it is kind of a surprise to me because it's really out of my knowledge. But something catch my attention. In this big system, there are so many people, thousands of people in this system. How did they manage to work? Right, so although not very effective, but they managed to move forward slowly. So I start to think, can we make programmers like soldiers? Can we do that? So we make programmers replaceable. So like a soldiers, if you replace someone in, they can take over very quickly, right? If we can do that, then I don't need to worry about the turnover rate anymore. So we start to look into it, and we find the answer is actually SOP, Standard Operation Procedure. Then we also have a training program implement to train out the people. So I call this age of SOPs. So we spend a lot of time just doing, just making SOPs. We have SOPs for the development, SOP on how to handle a task, SOP on how to handle the issues. And this is our organization chart by then. So we have different functional departments, different focus, and we have a project manager to coordinate among different departments. We also have a team leader for each team. The outcome, incident remains the same, it did not change so much. Turnover reduced. And I don't know why. But when I look into details, although the number looks very low, however the people left are usually the experienced people. Usually the more experienced people who spend there about 2-3 years in our organization. And they are normally taking up the team lead roles. Because in the previous one, you will see team lead need to report to both the project manager and department manager, right? So there are just too many pressure on them, and also they need to train out the newcomers, teach them how to do the task. So after some time they just burn out and left the company. This impacts to the product the most. The downtime increased by 200%. Because we do all the hard coding and skip the task, now it's a paying back time, right? So nobody there is there to change the system. Because whenever we change something else will be broken. And we don't know how to deal with it. However, during that time, I am thinking, how do we identify the productive people? Because there are so many people in the company, there must be some people who are more productive, some are not, right? So if we can find out those productive people, we keep them, then let the non-productive people go. So we start to kind of measure the productivity. So those are the things we have tried to measure productivity. And we start with the department KPI, start with the team KPI. Fortunately, we didn't have time to implement individual KPI yet. Then we start to measure like how development outputs, efficiency, and outcomes. Lessons learned for me was it really worked. Whatever you measure or improve, or it appears so. Give an example of if we measure the line of codes, the line of code will be increased for sure, right? Because we are all engineers, we are very good at numbers. We know how to make the numbers look good, although the things did not change so much. Then this is what I see by that point of time, because I see the people are leaving. They are leaving with the organizational knowledge, and also there are so many issues, so much downtime on our product. I don't know what to do there. So I see nothing. I do not see the future of our company. It's okay to say it now, but it's not okay to say it back then. Then we start to have some. We start to talk about Agile because we are kind of late. At the time we start to talk about Agile is about 2014. I believe most companies start to do Agile earlier than us. Then we start to try this by engaging a consultant to our company. Because then we say, okay, those are the five people who volunteer to do squad. So they are all yours. So you can tell them whatever you want them to do, including not going to the office or go out to gym or whatever. They are all yours. And we will review back in the next 3 hours, next 3 months to see the results. Because I cannot see it goes any worse, right? It's already at the bottom. We cannot go any worse. And after 3 months, I come back and I join into their spring planning session as an observer. So I was not allowed to speak or to participate because as an observer, you need to keep silence. So I was sitting there and watched them do the planning, and I was thinking, what the hell are we talking about? Because they are actually talking about very, very basic stuff or sometimes wrong stuff. And in my assumption, I would assume everyone in our organization, we are aware of those fundamental problems or fundamental system architectures. And that is also the reason why we stick with Scrum, because it allows me to see something I could not see before. It's a reality. We are looking at reality. The reality is people don't know what they are doing. But before that, because we have a team leads, we have project managers, they sort of cover up the reality, and they are very good at it. So we continue with the Scrum. Then what changed? There are many conversations going on in the company. Also, they use intensive posits. We even use the posit to catch a Pokemon. Right. And so I call this age of posits. In the age of posits, amazing things happen. This is our organization structure currently. So we have a department handle one or more products, and we don't let we already have the products to cost departments because that will increase the communication cost. And within each department, we have end-to-end teams. We break down the QA department, put all the QA into the team. And for the teams, we don't have team leads. We have a Scrum Master for each department. Incidents reduced by 40% this year compared to the last period of time. And human resource trend actually decreased quite a lot. We have about 10% of people leaving last year, and this year we have less than 5% until now. However, I also don't see that very low is a good indication, because maybe it also means people are getting too comfortable. Yeah. It's a manager point of view. Then we have a downtime reduced by 80%. And most of the effort, most of the credit goes to the technical parties. The continuous integration, the unit test, we can catch the defects before it goes on to production. So our product downtime actually reduced quite a lot. So this is how I feel now. I feel that I'm still in dark. However, I see a bright light over there. So if we move toward this direction, maybe we will be under the sunshine one day. Then this is what I pay most attention to in this period of time. So how do we communicate better? Because in yesterday's boss also talked about what the software we do was reflecting the way we communicate. So if we do not communicate effectively, our software will have issues as well. So those are the things we try how to make the communication more effective. I believe in Becky's session yesterday, she also talked about Sapir model. I find it's a very effective way to discover our assumptions and each how to realize the assumption from each other. Also, I believe facilitation is a one must-have skill for the Scrum Masters. So what I learned is actually there are many shades of grays, like between black and white. Actually, there are different options out there. Because I was an engineer, so I studied engineering. And in engineering, we tend to think the world is either black and white or 0 or 1, right? And there are actually nothing in between. However, in the real world, there are so many possibilities in between, but we need to find out by having conversations or having collaboration with each other. So those are the different ages we have. Among them, they have different behaviors. Those are some of the keywords I heard in different age of time. So in age of heroes, what I heard most is like commitments. You need to commit to your work. You need to finish it. In the age of my turf, I heard most is responsibility. So you are responsible to make this have to happen. In age of SOP, it's more like accountability, because we realize the work cannot be done by a single person. So it's a collaboration, you have accountability to make this work. However, in age of post-it, what we say the most is the ownership. It's about how do we create an environment to make people here want to contribute to a product by themselves, instead of forcing them. Also, we have different emotions. We did a survey to everyone in our company. So the survey was like, please say most significant emotion you have each year. So I guess something you can see here is the interesting appears everywhere. So I guess our organization is still interesting. The tiring is dominant emotion in the age of SOPs. And it is also reflecting my emotion back then as well. What surprised me is the two new emotions appear, which we did not have before. It's the happy and thoughtful. And I think it's quite amazing after 2 years that these two emotions appear. So those are the things we have tried in the past 10 years, the tools we have explored. And initially we start with, we focus on tools for process. Then in recent 2 years, we focus on tools for people. Now we start to focus more on tools for the products. The question might be like, okay, which aspect should we focus first? So we focus on product first, process first, or people first? I guess the answer is varies among different organizations, because we all got different contexts. However, I could suggest some metrics to measure to see the current current situation. I am not proposing those to be the KPIs. Okay, just some way to measure the current situation. So those are for products, those for process, and those for people. For people, I will pay attention to laughters and the use of number of post-its being used. Because I believe number of post-its, because engineers, we are all very introvert people, right? Since myself, I'm very introvert. So actually, we don't really like to speak. And post-it allows us is to write down our thoughts and share it, and make our thoughts express to other people. So I think this is a very powerful tool. So what's next for Titansoft? Actually, I don't know. I don't know what's next. Because we did not plan ahead for things to happen 10 years ago. We did not plan for SOP. We did not plan for the Scrum or Agile. What happened to us is actually inspect and adapt process. So we see the problem and we try to find a countermeasure and do something about it. So what I do know is that we will keep changing. And we are lucky that we are still surviving. So we can keep changing because only the dead organization cannot be changed. So now back to a movie. This is where I can sleep now. Not holding a handphone anymore. I hope someone else in our company is not doing that. So, and this cannot happen without the people. Although we mentioned that we can focus on people, on process, or product. But at the end of the day, we still rely on the people to make things happen, to create amazing stuff. And we also receive a lot of help along the way from different organizations and different communities. We are very fortunate to learn from the good teachers and good friends. So those are fine lessons learned in our 10 years journey. So always rely on team, not individual, because individual is very fragile, and it's from a risk management point of view, you need to rely on the team. So self-organizing team is actually, to me, is a quite effective tool to reduce the risk of organization session. And software delivery is easy, maintenance is hard. If your product is successful, what you measure will be improved, so be careful of what you are measuring. Just like we've read speech, he also mentioned, only measure what really matters. And there are many shades of gray, so we need to talk to each other, find out what's the best, what's the most suitable countermeasure at this point of time. Then when you finish changing, you are finished. So this will be my sharing for today. And I'm happy to hear your thoughts or comments or feedbacks. You are saying that you wish the code coverage to improve. But do you want the code coverage to improve or the quality of your product?
I also improve the corporate, but corporate is not a very concrete measurement index. For example, you cannot tell what's your quality, right?
You
what's your quality? But code coverage maybe is one indication. I won't say it's the code coverage is good and the quality is good, but at least it's some kind of indication.
Okay. It's an indication, it is only a good indication if there are no rewarding system with it. Mm. Okay, if you reward people to write a more code coverage, to have higher code coverage, people will make it 100%. That's very easy to do that. I believe for all software developers, you know how to make a coverage higher. So it really does not help in the quality of the product.
Yeah, so my question is, it's also kind of measurement, but do you really think it's really improve the thing you want?
No.
No?
No, I will not measure the core coverage. I would rather measure what's happened on the product. When, that's why we show the example of incidents. How many incidents have been happened on the production? Mm. That's more important. It's an indication of product.
So the problem is, it's not a problem saying what you measure you approve. It's the problem of what
it's
measurement
problem,
you are taking.
Yeah, it's a problem of measurement you are taking. And do you really want to improve your code quality or code coverage, or you want to increase the quality of your product? I think that's a question.
But the thing here is, for the quality of product, as what I say, is not something you can directly measure.
So no.
How do you...
So that's why I measure the instance. The number of incidents, the number of issues after the product is go live.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
I hope that answers your question.
Yeah. Cool.
developments and the ideas and the actual product that you make, so not the development side. How does that work, or how did it improve? How did it improve, or what were the challenges that you had in terms of engagements and being collaborative and building on a solution?
You mean in terms of teams?
Yes. So in the end, you came up with product teams.
Yes.
So, but what was the progression from like the whole, obviously the development team implements an idea that either a business analyst or a product owner has put together. But so how was that journey from the whole product definition side and creating a cool product and having the team being engaged?
Okay. The team will be engaged if some ideas are from them. For example, if there are some ideas that are products is contributed by them, they will be engaged. They will feel that I am also taking part to make this product successful. So if the teams are just ordered to do whatever they've been told to do, I see that it's very hard to keep them engaged because they will just be doing what they've been told. So if involved them into the product discovery process, which if they can take part with the product owners to come out the stories or items together. Not many of them, but maybe some of them, I believe it will help on the engagement. So they will feel that they are taking part to make this product more powerful, more awesome. Yeah.
And so did it improve?
Yeah.
Or was that not the issue? Was the issue more on the whole development?
It is an issue because we want engagement from everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if they don't have engagement, they cannot make good products, of course.
Hi, thank you for the interesting sharing about your journey. Just have one question to ask. So, I believe this is a proper for you to answer because you are managing many teams. So how do you evaluate the performance of the members in the product team?
Okay, it's a very challenging problem. What we are currently doing is we try not to have individual KPI. So we are having the team KPIs or product KPI. So actually everyone in the department is having the same KPI. Like regardless whether it's a PO, product owner, or a team, or other roles. Their KPI is the same, it's all focused on product. So everyone will receive 50% of their bonus is based on their KPI. And as you in the real world organization, we want to retain some good people, right? We want to have some. So we have another portion, which is for the manager to decide. But the majority is based on the whole team KPI, whole department KPI, based on the product. And we have a small portion just for the manager to decide for the retention.
So in that case, right? Since we talk about self-organizing team,
yeah.
Do you allow your people to choose to join any of the team by their own will?
Okay, we have a team forming process. So we for one department, we got about 20 people. So we let them choose what team they want to be at first. Then after that, we do not allow change to be so frequent because when we change team members, the team dynamic will change also. Then that impacts their delivery or their effectiveness. So we make changes, but we don't let the change make too often, maybe just once a year. Or after the forming, then after 1 year, if you want to change your team, maybe you can request then to change teams. Yes.
Any more questions?
Hi, I'm Yves. A little bit related. You mentioned you have restructured from Matrix to product-oriented teams, like QA, exist, it's embedded. How about support functions?
Support function, currently no, but we are working on it to put things in. Because actually, it took us about 1.5 years to get QAs inside the team. Because our organization, we don't want to just lay off people, right? So this is not our way of working. So we try to, we have some process to make people aware, to make every QA aware that this is something we do to put the QAs inside the team for the whole organization to be more effective. So we take down training, also we teach them how to do the coding. Some of them they don't know how to do. We also teach the developer to know to do the testing then they're aware of the importance of test. So that us take to us about 1+ years to put everything inside the team. I believe for support function, we were working on that, but it will happen gradually. I would not suggest a sudden change.
One simple question, do you link between the KPI and the measurement with salary and bonus indication?
Yeah. The KPI and?
It's KPI measurement. It's KPI, sound count, and salary and bonus stuff.
How do we do our KPI?
The question is, do you link between the two?
Do you link KPIs that
to
bonus or salary
increase? Okay.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks. So KPI we link to bonus, but we don't link to the salary. We kind of having a transparent. We start last year. We have a transparent salary scheme. So for the developers, they aware of their. For example, we have a job grade from 9 to 9, 10, 11, 12. So everyone in the job grade of 9, they receive the same amount of salaries. They know that. Then we have a promotion criteria, so they need to submit their promotion proposal, then to get promoted to 10. Then everybody in the 10, they will receive the same salary. And for the KPI, it's only to do with the bonus. It does not to do with the performance, because it's very hard to measure individual performance. I don't think it's possible. Individually. As a team, I think possible you do get a product. However, unless there's only one people in the team and doing one product, you can measure that. But if it's a team effort, I don't think you can measure it easily. All possible.
Yeah.
Hello. For the changes in your organization, so it spanned for 10 years, right, for the organizational changes. Were there any that were suggested from bottom up, or does the suggestion always came from you and top down?
You mean the suggestion to go for Agile or go for Scrum?
No, regardless of the change, because there are different ages, right?
Okay.
So from which the direction came to do the change first? Was that a suggestion from the team? That's my question.
Okay, thanks. So the question is whether it's bottom up or top down. So in the first 3 age, most of the changes are top down. As you can see, the management make a decision to make a changes. In the age of post-it, we make a decision to go for Agile and go for Scrum. And we try to involve as many people as possible in the decision making. So we also create an open space. Anybody familiar with open space technology? Okay, so we will try to create open space to gather information or to gather feedbacks. Yeah. So most of our top down. And now start to have some bottom up initiatives.
One question.
Yes.
You mentioned about the 996 phenomena, right?
Yeah.
I think it started in the age of heroes, right?
Yeah.
Now we are in the age of posters. Do you still see that happening, or is it better now?
You mean the 996, the long working hours?
Yeah.
It's become very less now. maybe not a good sign.
No,
it's become less. Then what happens is people will come to work if they really want to make something happen. So I think it's really meaningless to control the time they work, but rather we focus on what we want to achieve. So we do not work at that long now. However, the people will still come in by themselves if they like to.
I want to ask, what were the challenges when you moved to Agile Scrum at that time?
Okay, the challenge actually is more from structure-wise, because we have functional teams, and each functional team have a department manager, right? Like for example, QA have a QA manager, and front-end have a front-end manager. So it is very important to get the manager's buy-in. And I think they would personally would not like to see that because they are manager now. Then they see their department go away. Then what do I do, right? So actually, it takes a lot of effort to tell it's for the good for the organization. And actually, it does not affect what you are doing because now manager you become more like coach. As a QA manager, you become like a QA coach. So now your role is more to teach other people how to do the testing well, rather than command and control. So with this training and the software change, it's quite hard. But of course, you need to make people feel safe. You cannot say, oh, your department will go overnight. Then nobody else will support the transformation anymore. Yeah. Okay.
Has your use of Agile or the application of Agile evolved over the last few years? Like any new practices that you've taken on board or any that you've discarded along the way?
Practice or the technical
part? Yeah, the application of Agile in general, like maybe you've got your pair programming along the way or something, I don't know.
Okay, we do pair programming quite a lot. Pair programming and also we implement a continuous integration server. We start to write a coding test and we learning how to do TDD. And some people they use TDD already, some people are not. And those are a bit technical for me. So you can do for other guys at the booth. There are some engineers on there, we can share more details. But that's what I know. Okay, I guess that's all. And thanks for coming to the